Peter Willendrup from Technical University of Denmark and seconded to the European Spallation Source, a third of the time approximately. Let me just ensure also that I don't have, so you guys will be going to another screen here. That makes it all more visible for the recording and for myself. So I'm here to talk to you about the latest version of McStas, which is the 3.0 release, which, well, the main new feature in that is, in fact, that we now support use of graphical accelerators from NVIDIA, so GPU cards. And let me start by warning you with a few things here. First of all, this will be a little steep in terms of learning curve. So I will kind of assume that you know approximately what McStas is already. So this means I won't discuss any in any detail what McStas does and so forth. And also I will not really introduce the OpenACC language or the set of pragmas that we use, but just tell you that this is a kind of high level access to the CUDA programming language. And then there are some references there. You can look at openacc.org. And more importantly, for using McStas on GPUs, you can go and download the HPC software development kit from NVIDIA. Then I will make another warning, which is that I've managed to put together what is really too many slides here. Unfortunately, it's a topic that is close to my heart, and I'd like to discuss it for a long time and very detailed and everything. But as we have to leave some time for mass, and I also don't want you completely exhausted, I might actually skip ahead a little bit as we go through the slides. But the idea is that the complete information is in fact in the slides, and they are meant to be reasonably operational for your own work, porting existing instruments and components to McStas 3. So with that, let's move forward. I will cover topics of how well, or let's say how fast McStas runs on GPU, how the simulation flow is and what we changed. And then more in the more operational end of things, what do you need to do with an existing instrument or components to make it run with McStas 3? And then of course, I'll summarize at the end what still doesn't fully work. Here we are. So what you're looking at here is the main timeline of events towards the GPU. This is something that actually started back in 2017 when Emmanuel Fahy started modernizing our code generator. That was not really originally targeting the GPU as such, but it turned out to be a very nice platform to do this work in. The initial thought was to make McStas more object-oriented and potentially in the future more C++-like than the ISO C that we're currently using. Then we went to a few hackathons, two official hackathons with NVIDIA and the, what's it called? I think it's sponsored by the Oak Ridge Leadership in Computing Facility or something like that. So it is gpuhackathons.org that organize these events with experts from NVIDIA and local compute experts. I would even think that maybe you had one in the greater tomb setting earlier. Certainly it's something that happens in a lot of compute centers, Jülich, for instance, I would imagine. So we had two of these official ones, one in March 2018, another one in October 2019. And this is where something really started to happen. This is where we harvested the first results from GPU that started to look reasonable. And then we've had two events, let's say with ourselves, a January 2019 hackathon at DTU, a physical one. You see a few pictures at the top there. And then we did one virtual one in November 2020. Leading up to that, Eric and myself worked extensively on the 3.0 branch during the Corona lockdown here in Denmark. So actually the solitude of the home office has been quite useful in this respect. So the McStas 3 came out in December 2020. So what you're looking at here is a curve that explains a little bit about the speed ups that you can potentially expect from this code. So the data here are from a really idealized instrument. So there's just a source and a monitor in it. No absorbs or anything else. Everything runs purely parallel. And this means that this is probably a good indication of what the maximum speed up would be. What you're seeing in the curve is wall clocks on different types of hardware for different problem sizes in the given instrument setting, normalized to the wall clock of a single core simulation on a CPU. And of course, in the higher end of this, that normalization is an extrapolation because I would never run a 10 to the 10th simulation on CPU, right? Not a single CPU for sure. So what you can see there in the little zoom box on the right is that in this little problem here at 10 to the 12th, we actually max out at something like 600 times faster processing than what it would be on a single CPU. And this is then on a V100 card, which is a data center card that used to be top of the line, NVIDIA. And now there's an A100, which is approximately a factor of 2 higher than that. So that is actually around 3 orders in the ultimate case here, which is quite extreme, I would say. And then now comes a little bit more of reality here. In practice, and these are old numbers, I think they would still run or would still be relevant, but from November 2019, where we were really having our first results, what you see here is a simulation done with the PSI DMC model, so a diffractometer on, reactor source, if you like, or an always on spallation source as the PSI. And here you see that in practice, we find 2 orders of magnitude speed up. So what we would be able to do in a single call with this instrument for a 10 to the 9 problem would be 2000 seconds. And this we actually do in 22 seconds on a V100. And the message in general here is that if the problem has the right size and complexity, then GPU via the OpenACC mechanism here is actually quite nice. So if I just flip back to the earlier slide just for 1 second, you will of course see that below a certain problem size, it's actually slower to run a GPU. And this kind of consideration, you have to think about, of course, for your given problem. And I mean, the same goes for running on a big MPI run. There your processor initialization, et cetera, that may actually not be worth it in all settings. So if your simulation problem is small and simple enough, it might not be worth it. So this has to be considered every time, of course. Okay, so the main differences between McStas 2 and 3 is a rewritten and simplified code generator that generates much less generated code. It has improved compile time and is better at compiler optimization, especially for large instruments. And this is an advantage even on the CPU. So as you will see, we've gotten rid of a lot of defines that we usually had in our, let's say, global scope in McStas. And the different component sections now correspond to functions. And this is, of course, what makes the optimization run better. Makes the code more compact. So in an instrument with 100 guide elements in the past, you would actually have 100 duplications of the code. This is no longer the case. There's now a central function that performs the trace loop or the trace of the given component. And this is run 100 times instead. So that's a much more compact solution. So actually, a lot less global variables. The instrument itself, the components and the neutron are now all structs, as you will see. OpenACC is a pragma-driven language. So basically you tell the compiler via pre-compiler instructions how to go about the things you want to parallelize on GPU. And as much as we could is now put in place by our own code generator. So our code generator takes your instrument file and it writes something that is OpenACC oriented already. We had to implement a new random number generator because we couldn't easily port the Mersenne twister that we used in the past. We have something which is somewhat simpler now and parallelizable on both of the types of devices. Still with, if I should judge, more than the adequate, let's say, granularity in statistics. I mean, it'll still be, more than sufficient for what we need to do. This we also had to do because trying to use the CUDA random number generator showed quite a huge overhead. I think this is probably because they intend to do things like computational chemistry with it, which is really with billions of random numbers. And we are more in the end of hundreds, thousands or millions, something like that. And therefore spending a few seconds on that doesn't seem slow for computational chemistry, but it may be actually in the McStas setting. All our monitors are now actually dynamic arrays, and this I'll come back to a little bit. So the anatomy of a run on GPU, files and geometry, et cetera, is treated exactly as it was in historical McStas. It's handled on the CPU. You parallelize with MPI if needed, you build memory structures. This is all done on CPU. So meaning all the way through initialize in your McStas simulation is done on CPU. Then the last bit of initialize is to transfer the memory structures to the GPU. And then the full trace loop actually runs on the GPU. So nothing really happens on CPU there other than the bookkeeping required to be in synchronized with the GPU. At the end of the trace, or at the start of finally, you may say, we retrieve structures from the GPU, meaning monitor arrays and so forth. And then we do finally and save on CPU at the end of the simulation. One tricky thing is, of course, that if you want to debug what you're doing or have some poor man's physicist debugging in the form of printfing something, this is unfortunately not there on the GPU. Any such use of code is actually suppressed by defiance. So you're kind of flying blind, but I've developed a little set of tools that may help you there. I'll come back to what this is. So here is a screenshot of a profiling run on a GPU. And in essence here, so this is something taking 80 seconds or so. What you see in the middle there, the big blue bar or three of these, that is a nested description of what runs on the GPU, which is in this case, one big kernel, one big trace loop for all the neutrons in the simulation that goes in parallel on the GPU. It turns out that the limit in the number of threads that you can run on the GPU is something like max int, meaning 2 times 10 to the 9th. That's the problem size that you can at maximum push to the GPU. And if you go beyond that, what will happen is that we run bunches of 2 times 10 to the 9th, and meaning there's actually kind of a CPU loop around the GPU loop. What you can also do, and will be doing in some cases, is what we call the funnel mode. It is a different way of running your instrument, where actually the calculation is split in a number of kernels. You can activate it explicitly by setting a define, which is called funnel, or it also happens implicitly if your instrument has what is called a CPU component, this means please do the calculation for this component on the CPU, or if a component which is in your instrument has no ACC in the component header. So this will simply force that if you put one of the few components we have that are not GPU-fiable, if you put that in your instrument, what will happen is that the simulation can happen on GPU up to that component. Then we retrieve arrays with particles back to the CPU. They get calculated in whatever part of your instrument you want to be done on the CPU, and then potentially back to the GPU. So this is this kind of separation. It's done whenever you write a split in your instrument file, if you have a CPU component in your instrument file, or if your components use no ACC. And what more importantly happens here is, in fact, a kind of vitesse for those that know that. It means that we finalize the calculation in each of these zones. So if you start a million rays at the beginning, we calculate these through to, let's say, the sample position. We gather what the bunch of these are, and then we do another calculation for the next part of the instrument for this bunch of neutrons. A warning here is, of course, that this can and will be as slow as a single CPU the moment that you go back to CPU to do something. And also, there's a cost of copying back and forth from the GPU. The reason we have it in here is that, for instance, the union code that Mass will cover later is as of yet not fully ported to GPU. So the union master component, where the race in the union system happens, is actually a CPU component for now. Another example, I think this will actually be listed. No, it's listed here. It's multi-layer sample from Rob Dalgleish at ISIS. And this is for the reason that it uses an external library in the trace loop. Okay. So as an illustration, here's an instrument, a McStas 2 instrument on the left and a McStas 3 instrument on the right, a very simple one. So not a lot really has changed there. You may notice that there's a new section on the right called user vars. So this is for flags or other, let's say, state parameters that change with the particle, meaning a flag that signifies, did this one scatter on the sample or not, for instance. And this sort of thing has to go in user vars because it is then injected into the particle struct, meaning that it's private for the particle. Because the issue with running on GPU here is that actually thousands of particles are calculated in parallel. And this means that you really keep strict, you have to really keep strict what is particle related and what is common. So a mechanism to do that is called user vars here. Another thing is that it's not strictly necessary in the instrument, but I have actually moved, you see double constants equals two. This is now split so that you only have declaration in declare and all initialization happens in initialize. And the reason that I suggest to do this in the instrument is that you have to get used to that in the components. So let's jump to the components. Oh no, that's actually something about the particle first here, I can see. So in McStas 1 and 2, the neutron state is actually a set of global variables. So X, Y, Z, etc. And this is also what a flag would be. That would also be a global variable. This is now all wrapped in a struct, which is called a class particle struct. And in that you have position, velocity, etc. And this is also where the code generator will put your user vars. These can then be probed later on, for instance, with monitor ND by using user one equals flag, which is now a string. And then it does a lookup via a special function that we also write with the code generator called particle get var. And it also works with the normal particles states parameters. One important thing here is if you add something which is not an int or a double or something that then in a meaningful way can be cast to become a double, then it'll give junk. That's a current limitation in the system here. So the prototype of the function particle getVar cannot very easily change, in fact, as we found it. So that's the limitation. You can only probe these flags if they are something that can be cast to become a double. Then what is also important here is that the random number state is carried on the particle struct. And this is also to, let's say have, it's simply necessary, let's say, in the highly parallel system here that they each carry their own random number generator state. It cannot really be a global one because in fact, thousands of them are running in parallel. So there's a random number state on there. The one side effect of that is in fact that whenever you use a random number in a function called in the trace part of your instrument, it has to have particle, which is a local variable in the trace containing the particle state. This has to be in the footprint of that function. So if you have something that calls rand01 or rand norm or whatever, please pass the particle state to that function. Another interesting thing about particle state data not being global is that you should not use restore neutron any longer in a trace to do a local restore of the neutron state, because all that macro does is raise a flag that this neutron should be restored once you are done with the calculation in this component. So if you need to do a local restore, you should do that via a set of local variables in the given function. Okay, so here is one of the components. This is so simple. So what you see here immediately is that I've stripped out the output parameters. I didn't really need to do that, but the meaning of output parameters is really not there in McStas 3. Output parameters were used in the past to mask or let's say make a kind of prefixing in the case of having multiple components of a different of a class. So if you had two sources alongside each other, this was a way of making the parameters private to each of these. This is now done automatically because in fact the declare section in the component becomes the body of a struct, a named struct. So each instance, each of the source instances will have a struct associated with it that has this set of parameters. So another change here is that it's quite simple. In fact, you see that my declaration block is a few lines longer, and each variable is put on a line by itself here. And that is simply to ensure that our, let's say our parsing and our interpretation of the declare struct is as simple as possible. Because in fact, it becomes part of the struct representing the source symbol type component. So this has to happen in every component that should be ported to McStas 3. So in the PSD, in the monitor, for instance, we can have an example look at some other things that changed. Definition parameters. So let's say, how would you say that? Bare word or constant expressions for initializing our components is something that we had to take out. So definition parameters are simply not supported in McStas 3. I think on the next slide I will introduce a couple of new concepts that are there instead that will actually, as far as we can judge, be enough for any use that we saw in the past. So what it means in the monitor here is that the binning, the number of bins along X and Y, is now in principle something that can be dynamic. So it's not the moment you've written your instrument file, it's not cast in stone that NX and NY should be 90 or whatever you initialize by, you can actually use an input parameter in your instrument, for instance, to control how much memory you take up. So this goes together with the declare block. So on the left in McStas 2, you see ordinary static allocation of the arrays for the PSD. This is now instead in McStas 3, basically a two-dimensional pointer. It's called a D2 array, our little class, and we have corresponding D array 1D and D array 3D. And then what happens in initialize, as you see below, we have calls to a function called create D array 2D that then takes the inputs of NX and NY and creates or allocates the actual arrays. This, of course, then goes together. This should have actually been in the slide, I realize now. This, of course, goes together then with a destroy D array 2D in finally, because we should take care of some garbage handling here ourselves. So if I step forward again in the trace loop of the PSD, this is not so easy to read, I admit that. Access to the arrays, so meaning storing information about an incoming event in the event array, in the intensity array, and in the error array, this has to happen in what is called an atomic section in OpenACC. For those of you that ever did any thread programming, you heard the concept of mutexes, which is, let's say, a locking mechanism that ensures that only one thread at the time accesses this part of the code. This is, in fact, what this is. It means that only one neutron at the time can update the array. So this is what it means. And this has been implemented in all of the monitors. Then in the samples, we had to do quite a bit of detective work, in fact, to get things working. It turned out that we had a lot of misuse, I would call it, of component declare variables in trace for storing things that actually only related to trace. And the solution for that is, in fact, that anything that is a function of the neutron state has to really be a local variable in the trace on the GPU. And one could, of course, imagine for some things to do atomic sections like what we do in the monitors. But generally speaking, it becomes quite complex especially for things like the single crystal, where you have to, basically the list of available reflections, for instance, really varies with the particle. It doesn't really make sense to try to do that in a global sense, because it is not global. The neutrons can differ quite a bit. So this has a little side effect, which is that we used to have a check when using the component in connection with the split. You would actually have a look if the current neutron was identical to the one you just had, because then you could skip any calculation about reciprocal space and you could jump directly into selecting a reflection. This is not possible at the moment. We envision that in the future, we might have a mechanism corresponding to what is called the user var in the instrument that allows the component to say that there has to be room for, let's say, a reflection list or this sort of thing in the particle. This is not in place. And there are, of course, also other considerations. It might not work for every component we have in McStas. Think of isotropic SQ omega, where you have two-dimensional arrays and calculations based on those. Maybe too memory heavy to actually duplicate across across all threads. So let me jump forward here. A couple of tools for debugging. There's an event monitor symbol, which writes a simple log file with event data at the given point in the instrument. And this means This means that you can actually run that both on CPU and GPU, and because our threads actually have the same random number seed when running with the same seed from the command line, it means that you can directly compare what happens to a set of neutrons on CPU and GPU. So that's quite handy. And this you could do pre and post a sample, for instance. So you can really ensure that your given sample component behaves the same on the two systems. Then I've also added something called flex monitors that are like, let's say, the use of R mechanism in Monitor MD, but just a lot simpler. And both of these actually came about because it was quite hard to port Monitor MD. But so to really be sure what was going on in Monitor MD, I had to write some new code. But it all works now. So very useful for debugging and for looking at component internals is this sort of thing here. And again, I underline that on McStas 3, if you run with the same end count, the same seed, and the same level of MPI, the output should in fact be identical on CPU and GPU. And if it is not, then there's an indication there's something more to look at on GPU for sure. So this is something I will jump across, I think. So it mentions how the code block in the trace in a component becomes a function, and a little more further details on that. I'll just jump just to save just a little time. So compiler settings to compile for GPU. Well, we hope that in the future, at some point, we will be able to use GCC for this, but it's really not mature enough at the moment. And not all the pragmas we use to have our OpenACC running are actually supported by GCC as of yet. So we use the NVIDIA compiler. This is the one that was called PGI in the past. It changed name now to the NVIDIA compiler. It needs, first of all, a target architecture, that's TA. So TA equals Tesla means that this should go on a graphics card. And you can be more explicit if you want. So you can also say Tesla colon CC70, and this will then give you a compute capability 7.0 corresponding to a special kind of card. But generally speaking, it can figure this stuff out itself. We also use what is called managed mode. And this is CUDA shared memory for host and device. It means that every time you run a malloc or calloc or these sort of things, this is actually replaced by a CUDA malloc that ensures that you have a copy on both CPU and GPU transparently. And this is needed for our 2 and 3D arrays at present. It could be there's a small penalty, but we couldn't get rid of it as it stands. A useful one is called minfo equals axel, and this simply gives you a tree of the acceleration information. So it tells you that this function has been put on a GPU and that one, and then there's a loop and so forth. It can be quite nice to look at. And then we have OpenACC, which is a define we made ourselves, which is what TrueMaxDAS explains that this is a simulation that requires OpenACC. I should also say that MacRun in McStas 3 is pre-configured on Linux for this. So in principle, you can run for one of the included instruments, you run mcrun minus minus OpenACC when you compile, and then it works. And you can also combine with MPI if you like, if you have multiple hosts with GPUs, or if you have multiple GPUs in one machine, this is actually transparent. You may have to tweak the settings just a little bit to make the NVIDIA compiler pick up where the MPI libraries are, but that's normal in a way. It's the minus I for the include path and the minus L for the library path, as usual. Then what we also have is the possibility to run what is called the multi-core target architecture. So this is kind of emulating the thread GPU thread mechanism, but on CPU. So this gives you also another level of access to debugging your code. And if you do that, you might also raise the multi-core define. That means that you get back your printfs, et cetera. So you have a little more control in that setting because this is simpler. This is CPU, it's not GPU. And you also have control of these the inner loop, meaning the largest number of particle threads that are run on the GPU in one go. This you control with GPU underscore inner loop or GPU funnel inner loop. And here you see the defaults that that are in the code as it is. Okay, so what isn't working? A lot of stuff is. Unfortunately, you cannot do function pointers on GPU. So in one of the examples that comes to mind, Garrett Granroth from SNS has a source component that integrates two arrays or two functions via, it has an input, which is a function type. And this isn't possible. And my workaround there is that instead of using the anonymous function, I simply, and it really is a hack, I simply implemented the integration by duplicating the code. So it means that there are two integrations there that, just a second, there's a phone call here. I can't speak at the moment, sorry. So I simply implemented two integration routines alongside each other that explicitly integrates function A and B. So that is a hack. Another way is to mark the component no ACC. This, of course, then means that your calculation happens back on the CPU. So that might not be nice. So any type of variadic function is not available on the GPU. Variadic functions are functions with a variable footprint. So a non-static number of inputs to the function. This you cannot have on the GPU. So for instance, the printf-like functions are like that. And they are an example of stuff that doesn't run on GPU. Also, you can't have anonymous structs, for instance, as component parameters. You really need to declare what exactly the type of struct is. You can also not have, for instance, the user-defined field functions for polarization that we had in the past in McStas. So there's no solution for that as of yet. We may come up with a solution that that you can do something via the grammar, but otherwise what you could do is you could take and make a local version of the polarization library and hack in your own functions there. This would also work. Generally speaking, external libraries cannot be used in a function that runs in trace. And that's because it's a little bit hard to go and hack everybody's code, third-party code, to include pragmas. So there are two solutions there. So either you handle it in the initialize and finally instead, if you can. An example of that is the MCPL input and MCPL output. So they now read fully in initialize and write fully in finally, and then it instead it copies back some simple buffers back and forth to the GPU. Or you can do no ACC, which is for things like the multi-layer sample that uses the GNU Scientific library. And for now, Union Master is unfortunately no ACC, but this we will get working on GPU at one point. And then, a small embarrassment here. I think I've implemented a bug in the Nexus and Mantis stuff, just so you know. So there will be a McStas 3.1 where this is fixed within a few months. So porting an instrument to McStas 3 and GPU, you have to make any particle-dependent flags use of ours. You have to, for any input parameter that you use in the extent block or in when, etc., you have to use this macro called instrument underscore get par. So if you have a var name, which is an input parameter, and you want to check that in a when or extent, you use instrument underscore get par. You can say this is in fact not so different than what you had in the past. This is where you would have an MCIP in the old McStas, at least in the extent block. Then in specifically for GPU and on instruments, if you have something which is not an input input parameter and is not a user var, but still is accessed in trace, meaning in an extent or win block, you have to inject that to become a global variable on the GPU. And this is done via pragma acc declare create of the variable in declare and pragma acc update device in initialize. And similarly, if you execute any functions in the trace from your instrument, these need a pragma called pragma acc routine. It means this function should be compiled targeting the GPU. Then, of course, it might be that there's code in it that needs adjustment as well. But this is a first. You have to do that to run it on GPU. Common error messages you might get when with your compile. Things like invalid atomic expression, external variables used in ACC routine needs to be in pragma ACC declare, create, and so forth. The NVC compiler is quite nice if you use the M-info-excel to help you figure out these things. If you get an error 700, illegal address during kernel execution, that is in fact a seg fault. And it's often a symptom of illegal access. So colliding memory between two arrays, or you know, something ends up being NAN, or something is not thread safe, etc. So that that means that you have to go and investigate your code some further. Porting a component to GPU, all parameters must be setting parameters. And this means that the setting parameters now include a string type and a vector type. And the vector can be either allocated statically via curly brackets and a comma separated list, or via a pointer from your instrument file. And there are examples in the example catalog that has this. Any function declaration that you use in your component must be moved to the share block. And the declare block can only contain variable declarations, one variable on a line by itself with the type and a semicolon. That's the thing. All initialization resides in initialize. And now targeting GPU specifically, if the component uses external libraries, avoid using these in trace or use no ACC. Any function that is executed in a trace, just like in the instrument, needs a pragma ACC routine. Any function that calls a random number must include a underscore class particle pointer particle in the footprint. And that's because, in fact, it deeply in the code, rando, one, et cetera, are no longer functions that don't have a footprint. They actually have the particle because they need access to the state of the random number generator. Generally, don't store any particle-derived variables on the component struct. Make local trace variables instead. And if you have a monitor, what you will have to do instead is look at the existing ones and handle your arrays in atomic pragmas. And don't use restore Newton in trace to do a local restore. Highlights of components that work differently. Monitor ND, user vars are now strings because they use this lookup function. MCPL input and output do the most of the work in initialize and finally, respectively. And we transfer buffers for use in the trace. Powder N, single crystal isotropic SQ omega. Don't check for if this is the same particle as before. And we have a mechanism there that will make this work sometime in the future. So in conclusion, I'm getting to the end here. I think it really works very nicely. And the code changes are much less invasive than I had envisioned. So we had attempts in the past to do CUDA with McStas and to do OpenCL. And it's simply more or less required us to rewrite the whole code. This is not the case here. You mostly have to do small modifications of your algorithms, and then you have to put pragmas. And yeah, the changes are now, because we did the work on the code generator, they are actually quite small. And it often gives a speed up of 1 to 2 orders of magnitude over one CPU. And most things work. We have workarounds or solutions in the pipe for the rest. Unfortunately, documentation is a weak point. The released code and the examples, and then this set of slides is more or less what we have. We are really aiming to improve on this. So we will give you guides on the MacCode Wiki and so forth. And the manual also needs an overhaul. McStas 3.0 is ported to GPU, but not actually fully optimized performance-wise for GPU. So it might be that here and there, we can make it run even faster than it does. And we will try to get another NVIDIA hackathon to do that. And then I think we will need a dedicated hackathon to do the union stuff. And that's it. And this is the group of people that were involved. You know many of them.